So my study topic, improving productivity for pasture-based dairy farms. First of all, I'd like to start with some thank yous to my sponsor, the Geoffrey Gardiner Foundation. They've been absolutely tremendous. To Nuffield, Australia for making it all happen, and I think putting great structure around the scholarship program. And to my family for supporting me through what is essentially quite a selfish endeavour. I went farming a little bit later in life after a stint in banking, and my partner Jackie and I, we milked 450 cows in Gippsland and run a relatively simple system. So what got me thinking about productivity? Really, it was a search for more profitability and a recognition that I don't control the price of my inputs, I definitely don't control the price of milk, and I have different seasonal conditions to contend with year to year. So the only way that I could see that I could improve profitability was to focus on productivity. And we heard that this morning, I was comforted to hear from Brian as well. I was looking for things that would push the production curve outwards rather than focusing on the incremental things which happen anyway. What I'd like to see is that in the long run, I have a family business that thrives and that the Australian dairy industry becomes more competitive and is better able to withstand the challenges that will inevitably encounter. So it's nothing new to be looking for step changes in productivity, and obviously I soon realise there's no silver bullet. But there is a lot of international collaboration in terms of research. I still feel that a lot of this needs to be adapted for Australian conditions, and I'd identify two scenarios that are relatively unique to Australian dairy farming. One, we're family-based dairy farming, but we do need labour, and for us, labour is very expensive. We're a pasture-based industry, but we do incorporate a fair bit of supplement in our businesses. And it's also worth noting that Australian endeavours are pretty well advanced through investments in the past by industry, in the Dairy Future CRC, the Future Dairy Project in Camden and New South Wales, and also the Dairy Research and Development Centre at Allenbank. We're lucky to have these things. So I didn't want to get too hung up on the technical definitions of productivity, although I did look at them and research them, and some of them are in my report. But I decided to focus on four things. Improving labour efficiency, investigating improved feed conversion efficiency in dairy cows, growing more feed on the farm, and something I discovered along the way, you might call it precision dairy. So for me, improving labour efficiency came down to two things. Robotic milking, but not robotic milking in a voluntary fashion, which is what most people think of, but batch milking with robots and other farm robots. And what you see here is a Westphalia Dairy Pro-Q robotic milking system. This is the first commercial installation in the world. It's in eastern Germany. And so this is a normal rotary platform where every bale has a robotic arm. And this configuration requires one person as a supervisor. And 40 bales here, it has the capacity to milk about 160 cows per hour. Pretty exciting stuff if you're a dairy farmer. This is a generic robotic platform, comes from Canada, it's made by Clearpath Robotics. This particular one has been programmed by scientists at Future Dairy in Camden and New South Wales, and it can muster cows from a paddock. Now it's not too hard to imagine that something like this in the future can automatically bring the cows to the dairy for you, it could test the electric fence, it could take soil samples, it could assess pasture cover. Something like this would save a lot of time, a lot of labour. My second area of interest was producing more feed on the farm. And in southern Australia, we predominantly grow ryegrass, and I think this will continue to be the case. There are significant enhancements on the way. Much of these revolve around breeding techniques, selection of improved endophytes, the development of cultivar selection indexes, and a new cropping option called fodder beet. So So in the past, and still currently really, to develop a new ryegrass cultivar is a pretty time-consuming and expensive exercise and requires lots of field trials and typically takes 12 years for a new cultivar to reach market. The Dairy Futures CRC has developed a methodology using genomics that effectively cuts this development time in half. So in 6 years, a new cultivar can be launched to market. And this would not only double the rate of genetic gain, but also significantly reduce cost. This is an important point in Australia where we often struggle to justify the development of cultivars for our market as it is relatively small. Endophyte. There's huge potential with endophyte. Endophytes are fungi that coexist with grass plants. And in its wild form, it protects the plant from insect damage, but usually has toxins which impact animal health. We're now at the stage where endophyte can be selected and paired with grass plants that protect the grass plants not only in the leaves but also in the roots while having no negative animal health impacts. Both Ireland and New Zealand have developed cultivar selection indexes. You see here the Irish version, and it ranks different cultivars based on their profit potential per annum. You also have information relating to seasonal production, quality and persistence. This is the New Zealand version. It's called the Forage Value Index. They use a star system to indicate profit per annum. And a farmer in New Zealand can select the best ryegrass cultivar for them based on their region, based on the type of endophyte they're looking at, based on the ploidy, and also the seasonal production parameters they might be looking for. It's worth noting that Dairy Australia has something like this in development for Australia. Now, fodder beet, it's not a new crop, but it's effectively a new cropping option for dairy farmers. In New Zealand, well, the attractiveness of fodder beet lies in its enormous yield potential. I visited farmers in New Zealand where fodder beet has been taking off in the last 5 years that are seeing yields of up to 35 tonnes dry matter per hectare. Now to put that in perspective, on my farm, I'm going pretty well if I grow and utilise 10 tonne of ryegrass per hectare per annum. And a good crop of turnips might be 15 tonne. So it really is a game changer. As I left on my Nuffield travels, I wanted to investigate feed conversion efficiency in dairy cows. And I didn't realise at that stage that Australia, in conjunction with New Zealand, was really leading the world in that research. So I won't speak too much about it because it's effectively being done. And what has been done is a genomic prediction value has been developed because to commercially, well, to assess feed intake at an individual cow level in a commercial herd improvement scheme is just about impossible. So the Australian Dairy Herd Improvement Scheme recently released a breeding value called Feed Saved, which was a world first. But I'd like to highlight the potential of using genomics at an individual herd level. I visited a geneticist called Dr. Donna Berry in Ireland, and he's coined this term called reprogenomics. So what he's saying really is that we now have the ability to tailor individual cow fertility treatments based on how responsive or unresponsive she might be. And you know, that could save a lot of money. The same is true of different farm management decisions. And for instance, I might, using that information, I might only choose to dry cow cows based on high risk profile. And that's something that costs me, for instance, $35 per cow. So if I only need to do half the herd, there's significant savings. Now, precision dairy. I just show here some of the technology which is on the way. And this is not currently for sale in Australia, but this example is made by Dillabelle. It's called Herd Navigator. It's for sale in Europe, and I saw it on a farm in Sweden. What this does is it automatically takes milk samples throughout a cow's lactation. And this allows the farmer to identify when the cow is cycling, when she's in calf, and quite importantly, if she remains in calf through her lactation. it also provides information on whether the cow is likely to have an animal health event before there are any clinical signs. It's a pretty nifty device. It can even help the farmer optimise the dietary requirements of that cow based on those milk samples. There's a lot of sensors coming on the market. This cow here, she's in Kentucky at a university research farm. And as you might not be able to see, but on every leg she has a sensor, and around her neck and in both ears. So the scientists there they're really developing the algorithms so they can identify the link between the cow's behaviour and subsequent animal health or fertility events. And I would say with sensors, we're really at the first iPhone stage, where there's an awful lot of capability yet to come. So I've taken the liberty of putting my spin on what I think we might need to do to make sure we capture the benefits in Australia. So batch milking robotics, really exciting, but obviously quite expensive. I think there's the potential for the dairy industry itself to help develop a new financing model. And this would encourage uptake, but also crucially allow farmers to maintain the technology at an up-to-date level. There's currently a lot of research based around voluntary cow milking and robotic systems. I see this as, in the future, there will be some farmers that choose this technology, but for the majority of the market, they will probably go the batch milking robotic way. So some of this research could be redirected into understanding how other technology can be put around batch milking robotics. Fodder beet. What we need with fodder beet is we really need the Australian recipe, what the best sowing dates are, what the best cultivars are, and how does it fit with our dairy production systems? Would we actually make more profit even with that enormous yield? Currently, some of the weed control sprays required are yet to be licensed. I mentioned that Dairy Australia has a cultivar selection index in development. That's great. I think that concept could be taken further. If we allow farmers to put in their individual data based on where they are, which region they're in, the growth rates that they're seeing, by paddock, what fertiliser treatments they may have used, or what sprays they may have used, we would effectively have what I call a ryegrass knowledge bank. And with precision dairy, farmers obviously like to learn by looking at other or talking with other farmers. And in a related concept, I propose a new demonstration farm as a way of highlighting the benefits of precision dairy. And I see this working best in a model of a partnership model where we will bring the best technology and the best brains together and then quantify some of these benefits so we can demonstrate to farmers what is possible. I also think that precision dairy has the potential to impact the value chain. And I'll just use one example. So the dairy farm in the future would have an enormous amount of information. And if this information was shared with the milk processor would much more accurately be able to predict their milk intakes. And if they use this information in discussion with their customers, they would be able to effectively optimise their product mix. And if they can do this, they would be in a position to pass back fairly dynamic price signals to us on farm. And it would be my hope that this might reduce volatility. Data is going to become increasingly important, and we will rely on information far more. In dairy, we're pretty good at co-ops. I think we could have a dairy data co-op. Farmers would own the data. And this would be good for two reasons, well, more than two reasons, but two of the best reasons, I think, are that industry good research would still be able to be carried out without data being captured by individual companies. And that this would also allow farmers to switch between technology providers rather than being beholden to one provider. So you might say, what am I changing on farm? Well, I'm obviously limited by farm finances, but when I can, I intend to invest in batch milking robotics. This will do two things for me. Not only will it reduce labour and make the milking process, you might say, more enjoyable, but it will also bring many of those precision dairy technologies really what I mean is the information that comes with that. I plan to trial fodder beet once those sprays are licensed, and because weed control is essential for a very slow developing crop like fodder beet. I've already started to incorporate that new breeding value called feed saved in my breeding goals with our herd. But I think I'd like to investigate the use of genomics within my herd a lot more. And in the first instance, I can see that I might choose to only make some of my replacement heifers to more expensive sex semen, where I know that those heifers are good quality animals and more predisposed to respond to the lower fertility sex semen. So in summary, I think the future is very bright, and I'd like to leave you with some questions. What sort of on-farm productivity will we see anyway? And where should industry investment be targeted? And is there any alternative to investing in productivity at all? Thank you.